Well, thanks everyone for joining us. My name is Ahmed Masri. I'm a cardiologist. I work here at Oregon Health and Science University. I oversee the cardiomyopathy section and practice here. I spend lots of my time taking care of patients with amyloidosis as well as hypertrophic cardiomyopathy and other genetic cardiomyopathies as well. So we'll be talking to you today a little bit about TTR, sharing some cases, and we're very grateful for our patients who are joining us today, and then we will have a live demonstration with one of our senior experienced sonographers, Dr. Jim Hodovan, who's going to scan live for us as well.
Hi, everyone. Thanks for joining us tonight. My name is Sarah Cuddy. I'm a cardiologist at the Brigham and Women's Hospital in Boston. My specialty is really just in cardiac amyloidosis, and that's where I see patients uniquely with this disorder. And also, I'm a multimodality imager as well, so have trained in all modalities, MRI, CT, nuclear, and echo, and most of my clinical and research has been in echo and MRI and some nuclear.
Thank you. We're hopeful for this session today that we can show you some of the things that don't necessarily have to look classic on echocardiography or with clinical presentations that can make you think of amyloidosis. When we think about TTR amyloidosis, we're really thinking about what's happening at the heart level, at the nerve level, as well as orthopedic. There are about 27 types of amyloidosis. It's just a very generic term that describes protein sitting between the cells. From a cardiac perspective, or from a systemic perspective, the two common ones are TTR and AL. So what happens? With TTR, we all have TTR. There's not a single human being born without transthyretin. And so it must have some functions, essentially. But these functions seem to be less relevant as we get older. And what happens is your liver secretes lots of transthyretin. It's very, very abundant. And if biology goes wrong, even if you were not born with a predisposition for that, if biology goes wrong, the tetramer, which is four parts of the protein, falls apart and starts depositing in the heart and, you know, different tissues. If you were born with a mutation that predisposes you to this, the pattern is slightly different. One can have more nerve disease and can have more, you know, some other problems at an earlier age. So that's what differentiates wild type from variant disease. Variant is something you are born with, so you have the predisposition to developing the disease, while wild type is not. Now, the second one we're not going to talk too much about, but it is extremely important. This is light chain amyloidosis. It is important because, just as I've seen today, 6 to 12 months delayed diagnosis means the difference between someone just getting some medications and, you know, cruising along to someone needing heart kidney transplant, and I don't know if we can even get them through that. And that was just a delay of 6 to 8 months. And so when you think about amyloid, always please check light chain amyloidosis. When you have someone with LVH that you have no, you know, necessarily like clear explanation for it, if it's within the right age, the right settings, you know, you should check light chains, you should check serum and urine immunofixation, which are looking for a protein band there. And so you can make it part of your practice. And so TTR amyloid has been a historical challenge because we think about it when we look at advanced disease. When they think of amyloid, they think that the walls have to be massively thick and the heart doesn't have to squeeze, essentially, which is not true nowadays. You can have a whole spectrum of how amyloid looks like on echocardiography. The need for cardiac biopsy and the lack of medications pre-2018, 2019 really made it more academic. You're like, why do you care about knowing if someone has amyloid, TTR amyloid or not, if you can't do anything about it? And now we spend the last 6 years trying to learn what the disease looks like, how things are. We used to think that women, it's near impossible for women to have wild-type amyloidosis, transthyretin amyloidosis. Now we actually have women. I'll show you some data with wild-type amyloidosis. If you look at HFpEF, about 5% of the patients could have concomitant disease above the age of 65. If you look at aortic stenosis, same story. If you look at systematic screening in the community, if you look at patients you sent for TAVR, about 5 to 10% of them will have concomitant amyloidosis. And so that could be part of the reason why lots of patients post-TAVR still have heart failure. So keep that in mind. And so one really important thing, even though here we're in one of the whitest states in the U.S., it's really important to remember that in patients who are black or Afro-Caribbean or of Western African descent, they could be born with a predisposition for the disease. This is V122I, a specific amino acid change mutation that leads to tendency to develop the disease by the sixth or seventh decade of life. if it's heterozygous, if it's homozygous, because, you know, you could have two parents, you know, can have both parents with heterozygous mutation, then the disease can come up earlier in the 50s and the 40s even. We're talking about 3.4% of all Black Americans have this. If you look at the U.S. census, that translates to about 50 to 100,000 patients that potentially develop the disease. Not all of them obviously develop the disease. So really important to keep that in mind. This is a quick paper we put out because it was fascinating to me that prior to 2016, 2017, there were no women, as far as I know, and I asked a lot of people around me in Oregon or in our practice, that were diagnosed with wild-type amyloidosis. They were all men. However, it became very clear that part of this, because people are accustomed that there is no TTR wild type in women. So no one looks at that. And so since we've started to look more and since we've had treatments and you don't need an endomyocardial biopsy, we have found a lot more women with wild type compared to before. It is true though that the phenotype looks very different and they actually live much longer. They have still heart failure, but they don't die at the same rate that you see essentially men dying on if you leave them untreated. And so there are so many diagnostic algorithms there. You can pick and choose whatever you want. And so I'll move from there to just say that think about amyloid when you can and when you're able to. You can create smart sets in your practice. If you see heart failure patients, aortic stenosis patients, patients with LVH, you can create a smart set. You can hit the pointers, neuropathy, carpal tunnel, ruptured biceps tendon, ruptured Achilles tendon, shoulders, knees, the spinal stenosis. Like, these patients will tell you all of these things, and unless you're thinking about it, you're going to ignore it. But the reality is most people have that. And then lots of patients actually have lower BMI. So they've been active all of their lives. Their BMI is typically below 30. It's very uncommon. It still happens, but very uncommon to have someone who's obese with transthyretin, wild-type transthyretin amyloidosis. And, you know, when you think about all these things, you need to just to do really two main things. One is you need to rule out light chain amyloidosis. You just need three tests for the rule out, three light chains in the serum, not the urine, just the serum, three light chains. You need serum immunofixation or immunotyping and urine immunofixation and immunotyping. People are used to SPEP and UPEP. Those don't count. You need to do immunofixation and or immunotyping, and you do the three light chains. And so the second thing is that you need to think about TTR after you've done the AL. You can do them concurrently. TTR, essentially thinking about it, is doing bone scintigraphy, which is in the U.S. we only have two tracers approved, not specifically for this, just approved in general, pyrophosphate scintigraphy and HTP. HTP is more sensitive than PYP, but you can use either, it's fine. And then if you can use SPECT CT, like let's say that this doesn't financially affect you and you have a choice of sending someone to a SPECT or sending someone to a SPECT CT, always try to go to the SPECT CT. It makes a huge difference in the screening and diagnosis of this condition. You know, we've had talks before about how things could look like each other and you can separate them. And this is essentially one patient has hypertension only, the other has hypertension and V122I variant transthyretin amyloidosis. It doesn't matter if I tell you which is which. The bottom line is that we're not so good about differentiating what's caused by hypertension and what's caused by something else on top of hypertension. So just keep an open mind. Obviously, someone who's 30 years old coming to you on six medications for high blood pressure and everything else checks out, you don't have to do anything else necessarily, except in the right circumstances. But someone who's 60, who's like, doc, I've been doing so well to the point where I'm starting to chip off some of my blood pressure medications. That means that actually they're getting into trouble because their blood pressure is behaving better. Blood pressure is behaving better not because they're getting better, but because their cardiac output and stroke volume is going down from something else. So keep those things in mind as you go. S-wave, very few people look at that, but it's extremely useful. You actually don't need strain imaging, even though we're at ASE. So strain imaging is very helpful. But the first complaint that I get from everybody is that I don't have access to strain, or our images for our population are not good enough. If you can do strain, amazing. If you can do strain, don't complain. You have the S-wave. So you do the lateral base, which we'll do here today, the lateral base better than the septum with the S-wave, which is the systolic wave that happens timed with the QRS, not your E prime or A prime. And this is a very good screening tool that equates basal GLS, segmental GLS. If it's low, less than 6 centimeters per second or so, that's a red flag, especially if your EF is good. If your EF is 55, 60, 65%, and this is low, you need to explain why is it low. And, you know, voltage mass ratio, it's mind-blowing that because we moved from the traditional private practice where you would read your own EKG and you would do your own echo and you would read your own echo and you see at the look at the patient and do all of that in a row, we now have to convince people to, when you're taking care of patients who have LVH, please pull the EKG and the echo at the same time and look. If you have low voltage, especially in the limb leads, and you have LVH, try to explain it. Someone who has severe COPD, you're done. It's reasonable. They could still have TTR, but if you don't want to essentially focus too much on that, that's reasonable. If someone is morbidly obese and they have low voltage and you can have a good story about this, that's also reasonable. But most of the time, we actually see people who have absolutely zero reason to have low voltage on EKG and also they have LVH. That's the simplest clue you can go after in these patients. And this way you can capture almost 2/3 of your patients, actually, if you attach the two together. Either one of them, no, you're going to have a lot of lack of specificity. And so I go back to the same principle because I do cardiomyopathies. Explain all LVH. Is it hypertensive heart disease? Is it not? It's a structural heart problem that actually kills a lot of people. And so try in your practice, like you do for chest pain, like you do for low ejection fraction, try to explain why someone has LVH. And so relatively speaking, it's not one of the ultra-rare diseases that you can see once in a lifetime. No, you actually do encounter this more often than not, which tells me either we're really, like, the odds are working really in a weird way, or you only find amyloid if you're essentially looking for it.